Good morning, everybody. I am to present an osteo left main stenting. Actually, this is a guy, a 51-year-old person who was a known diabetic, had unstable angina with good LV function in 2011. Coronary angiogram was done, which showed double vessel disease, borderline LAD and LCX disease. We done an FFR on his LAD, which was okay and it was negative. So we put him on medical management, was doing good for the last 2 years. Now, on 9th of last month, he actually presented to the hospital with chest pain, had since 5 days. ECG had fresh changes in the anterior leads. There was no RWMA, had good LV function. Admitted him for a coronary angiogram. Was admitted around 7 o'clock in the morning. He was in the post-cath, elective angiogram, absolutely stable. And exactly when we were taking up for the angiogram, when he was being rolled into the cath lab, he actually started developing breathlessness, severe shortness of breath and chest pain. Pressures dropped to 70 millimeters of Hg and he was profusely sweating. We took an ECG in the cath lab itself and we were shifting him onto the table. It showed ST elevations in AVR and significant ST depressions in the anterior leads. First thing which we did was to put in an IAVP. We had actually reviewed his angiogram the day before to see actually what had happened and what exactly we are going to deal with. So we knew that it's a non-dominant left circumflex. So actually with this situation, non-dominant right coronary. So we actually took in a left guide. And this is what we actually had a surprise was he had a tight left main ostium. This is like kind of a slightly rude shock for us because 2 years ago, absolutely clean LAD, left main and LAD was borderline. So, took in different views. Actually, the osteal left main, iliocranial and apicranial actually give us a better idea of what's going on. So, actually, if you can see here, the apicranial showed a very clear picture of the ostium of the left main. And we immediately passed in a wire into the LAD and took in a stent there. We did not think we should pre-dilate there because we didn't have too much time. Pressures were dropping. He was very unstable. Actually had a run of ill-sustained VT as well on table. So just took in a PROMIS element 4:16 and positioned it in apicaudal and apicranial. And dilated the stent. Once we dilated the stent, we actually patient actually after the dilatation became stable. He tolerated the dilatation of the stent. It was a very quick dilatation and deflation. And then we actually withdrew the balloon and dilated the ostium again so that it flares up the ostium. And then took in the guide and had a shoot. The stent had opened pretty well. Pressures had settled down by then. He had pressures of around 110, but with ionotropes. This was the final result. The RCA was non-dominant. In this situation, in the hurry, we actually did not do an IVUS because the patient was too unstable for us to actually meddle with him too much. So finished off with the post dilatation of the ostium and came out. And on our way back, we actually plugged the artery with a vascular plug and came out because we didn't want, it was a clean puncture, so we thought we had used a 7 French. So just finished it off and came out. It was a good result. Otherwise, patient stabilized. The first 2 days, his pressures would shoot up to around 140, 150 and then again drop to 90. It took a day or two before he actually stabilized and settled down after that. And day two, we removed the IVP, and day five, he was discharged. 2 days, he was in the ICU, and after that, we discharged him on day five.
Okay, sir, nice demonstration of an osteal stenting. But this is definitely an exceptional circumstance. But generally, for osteal lesions, it is better to predilate because the pathology is quite different. Yeah, it might be fibrotic. And a cutting balloon may also maybe needed at times.
Actually, so it was too unstable. Actually,
I know. What I said is this is a special circumstance. But generally a predilatation is recommended.
Right. Probably he had a plaque rupture there.
Yeah,
which
possible,
actually,
possible.
Yeah. But two things. I mean, choice of the length of the stent is interesting, as well as the choice of a stent. Both of them are interesting. Because, you know, generally, you know, the limitations of osteo left main is that, you know, the length of left main is generally small and you try to take as shorter a stent as possible. So one would like to put a 8mm stent or, you know, 9 at the most. But putting a 16 is...
No, actually, honestly speaking, we had used a 12 just before the case before that, we had used a 12.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying.
Board actually.
The second interesting part was that choice of PROMAS element stent, because you know that, you know, little bit of a stent would be protruding in left main. And, you know, PROMAS are little more liable for longitudinal stent issues. So, you know, that is why I'm saying that it is rather, you know, interesting choosing PROMAS, you know, because... knowing that there could be slightly higher chance of longitudinal, you need to, suppose you want to rehook the
left
artery,
main, yes.
Then you know this guide catheter can
actually,
cause this.
All this was done in such a rush.
No, I agree with you. So, I mean, what I'm trying to say is that, you know, all these things are there and we are in terrible emergency and terrible hurry, but you know,
what was on board there and in
yeah,
the lab
you just
actually
put
used
it there.
At that
that's
point
that's
in time and finished
off. I mean, I completely agree with you.
Was there any plaque in the left main at the time of the angio 2 years back?
No, absolutely nothing.
Can you show the angio after the circumflex, osteo circumflex, the plaque previously? Maybe you should check it later.
But anyway, no patient saved, so
yeah,
that's
yeah.
It.
But later date, I mean, it might have to.